Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our very first Wednesdays in Wiedemann of this 22-23 season of the RBOS, Re-Bloomfield Organ Series, which is just ahead of us. We have an exciting season, and it starts, well, today, and the next event will be our first distinguished guest artist on Tuesday, November 8th, Clive Driscoll Smith. He's English, but he's living in Texas right now. Very exciting player. And then our second distinguished guest artist, and it's a special concert, organ and orchestra, with our very own WSU School of Music Orchestra, directed by Mark Laycock. Concerti by Poulenc and Guillemot are among the works that are going to be performed, along with a Christmas sing-along at the end of the second part. So you won't want to miss this special organ and orchestra concert. All the events are live streamed. We had a little problem today with today's live stream. That's why we're starting late. I apologize. But they're live streamed on the School of Music Facebook page, and you can subsequently see them afterwards as well. And you may attend in person, which is the only way you can benefit from this screen over here with the pedals and the manuals. This is only for you. And you can always find information at wichita.edu/organ. Today's program is comprised of Bach's Prelude and Fugue in C minor, BWV 546, I can never say that, and Franck's Chorale No. 1 in E major. Colossal, complex, with a distinct power of inspiration, richness in the writing, including Bach's own predilection and preoccupation with symbolism, this is how one can describe the great prelude in C minor that you're about to hear. It evokes the final chorale in Bach's own St. Matthew Passion, also in C minor, the tonality of energetic suffering, of familiarity with death. This feeling of death is so present in this work, so impressive, that one could think that perhaps Bach is writing, took his inspiration from a personal experience, or is writing an eloquent commentary on a liturgical text. But one of the most striking effects, and one you don't hear, it's just cerebral, really, and marvelous in its execution, is Bach's use of symbolism. There are 144 measures in the prelude, the number 12 having such a great importance in the scriptures, number of perfection and accomplishment. It's also the sum of the letters, 144, forming the first name of Bach, Johann Sebastian, his signature. We find the same extraordinary thing in the fugue in C minor, an imposing five-voice work, which numbers 158 measures, 59 with the last chord, which are the sum of the order of the letters composing Bach's complete name, Johann Sebastian Bach. We heard the first part of this complete work as the postlude to the funeral services of Queen Elizabeth II, first in St. Giles Cathedral in Scotland, then at the end of the service in St. George's Chapel, Windsor. It was also played at the funeral of Lady Princess Diana. The heaviness and expression of grief throughout this work makes it especially poignant and suitable for such events. But in them, through the themes, the rhythmic figures, the harmonic development, we are also led into that particular sort of light and hope with which Bach always infiltrates his work. Hence, both the prelude and fugue end in a Picardy third, C major. So we go from C minor, and we do end in C major. Here now is the prelude and fugue in C minor by Johann Sebastian Bach. The Three Chorales by César Franck were his last works just before the accident which caused his death in 1890. And the use of the term chorale refers to the Protestant Lutheran chorale as a sung hymn with a sacred text. If it were a Catholic version of it, it would be based on a Gregorian chant in Latin, but always with a sacred text. Here, Franck departs from the Protestant chorale, or a piece based on the Catholic plain chant, to write a chorale tune without words, neither religious nor secular. So the music is anonymous, not linked to a sacred text, becoming, in a sense, a secular work. In these three chorales, he shows his maturity and a will to eliminate what constituted the fashion of the day, which were pastorals with lightning and thunder. So he was out of the ordinary, which was good for us down the line, 200 years later. This is specific writing for the organ with specific registration, very different from what you've just heard with Bach. As always, linked to the Cavaillé-Coll organ in the Church of Sainte-Clotilde in Paris, where he was organist. In this chorale, number one, in E major, Franck uses the principle of the theme and variation. The chorale is still a beautiful melodic theme, but without words, to which Franck almost invites his listener or the performer to write his own words. So expressive and singing is it. He's said to have told Vincent d'Indy, "You will see, the chorale is not the one you think. The real chorale, in the manner of a hymn, played like a hymn, but with no words, takes place even during the work." Once again, here is a work that is also appropriate for a funeral, as such as that of Queen Elizabeth II. But even in its joyous key of E major, it gives off an impression of hope, light, and triumph over death. Here then, in commemoration of the bicentennial of César Franck's birth, 1822-2022, here is the chorale, numéro 1, en mi majeur.